three critical questions that are the foundation, I think, in a lot of ways of apologetics. Is the approach true to the Christian truth claims? Is the method that we're using to try to do apologetics, to persuade our audience, our culture, is it true? Is it consistent with the Word of God? Is it emulating and reflecting a biblical worldview? Second, is such an approach viable in the marketplace? Is the method at which I'm going about apologetics actually persuading people? Are they being convinced? Are light bulbs going on? Are they experiencing paradigm shifts in their thinking? It's what we're after. And then thirdly, on what basis should we defend the Christian faith? We should defend it based upon public, acceptable criteria of truth, because truth does exist. So, absolutism. The idea that error exists at all presupposes that there is truth. Moral propositions. Murder is wrong. One ought to tell the truth. People are more valuable than things. B, moral absolutism. Absolutists hold that moral rules are frequently self-evident. In the same way that mathematical truth is self-evident. We don't invent morality. We discover it like we discover multiplication tables. So we're going to talk about two nuances of this. First, you have a blank there. A moral proposition is true irrespective of the beliefs of individuals or cultures. I'll repeat. A moral proposition is true irrespective of the beliefs of individuals or cultures. So it's true not because I believe it to be true, not because we take a majority vote and 51% say it's true, but because it's true in and of itself. Sure. A moral proposition is true irrespective of the beliefs of individuals or cultures. This is what's called an objectivist position. It's objectively true. It's the opposite of what we're going to be talking about in a couple of minutes, subjectivism. It's true if I choose to believe it. This is the most important sense of absolutism. It's objectively true. It's true irregardless of what anybody thinks. Thus, this would say, in conclusion, we discover, not determine, morality or morals. We discover it, we don't determine it. We don't take a voice vote and say, hey, you know, the majority said, you know, it's okay to terminate your pregnancy if you want. I'm sorry, majority vote doesn't make something morally right. Doesn't make it right for the Supreme Court to say, hey, if you're African American, you're 3/5 of a person. 1858. Supreme Court, 1941. If you're a Japanese American, we can violate your constitutional rights. We can put you in a concentration camp simply because you're Japanese in your ethnicity, even if you were born in America. In 1973, Roe versus Wade, you can terminate the life of your child anytime you want because the child doesn't have any rights. Japanese Americans don't have any rights. African Americans don't have any rights. Because the U.S. Supreme Court decided so. 1858, strike one. 1941, strike two. 1973, strike three, you're out. You've been wrong three times in a row. So we discover truth, we don't determine it. Thank God the government doesn't determine morality. We'd be in more problems than we are now. Number two. Blank. Moral propositions are universalizable. Moral propositions are universalizable. In other words, if it's true for one person, then they're true for all others in similar situations. Moral propositions are universalizable. Some comments under this. Moral principles are exceptionless. At least that's the thought pattern here. That's open for some discussion, which I'll present some dilemmas to you. Not necessarily answer the dilemmas, but I'll give you a couple of dilemmas. Second subpoint on this, the logical slippery slope argument. A is wrong. B is relatively similar to A. therefore, by implication, B is also wrong. So, for example, sex before marriage is wrong. But things that are closely tied in with sexual intercourse also, because they have a close association to that event, should also be considered wrong. So, one of my students today was saying, one of his friends, Aunt Viola, doesn't have sex with his girlfriend, sex, Bill Clinton type sex, but he's got sex, Bill Clinton style sex, with his girlfriend, Viola students. So they're involved in oral sex, but they're not really involved in sex sex. That's the Bill Clinton motif. But if sex before marriage, fornication, is wrong, then taking your clothes off and satisfying one another sexually is also wrong. If marriage betrayal, divorce, is wrong, then maybe it's wrong for you to be involved in an inordinate, intimate, emotional relationship with another person of the opposite sex, other than your, take it from the guy's standpoint, your wife. Or for you ladies to have an inordinate, emotional, romantic type connection with a guy, but you're married and that guy is not your husband. Now maybe your husband's a total derelict and bum. That's possible. That's why you ought to be very careful who you say I do to. Because you may be a little bit disappointed with the sticker shock after you buy the present. Cost a lot, you get into the relationship and say, gee whiz, this is not what I counted on. But now, you know, I'm in this relationship for the next 65 to 70 years. So it would be really good for you to be more cautious at making that I do decision. I've asked a number of my brothers in Christ that I mentor, I'm not trying to control your life. I don't know the future. I'm just trying to help you make good choices. And so I want to ask you to consider, doesn't have to be me, but it should be somebody, don't marry a woman unless I agree. Now, if you want to get somebody else that's a good mentor in your life, that's fine. Make the same deal with them. I don't have to be the point guy. But if you want me to be the point guy, I'm happy to be the point guy. Will you agree with me not to marry a woman unless I agree with the relationship? And I've had four guys take me up on that. Three of them are married. Fourth one, I want to ditch the relationship. I want him to ditch the relationship. So it's going to be interesting as time develops if he asks her to marry him and then he comes to me and I say, I'm totally opposed to it. It's a bad relationship. It's not going to be good, and you're going to end up divorcing her in 3 to 5 years after you marry her. But as they say, love is blind and lust is even more blind. Lying is wrong, so maybe intentional deception is wrong. One of my children used to be very good at this. Did you do this? Did you open the front door and let somebody into the house? As we said, nobody's to come into the house while we're gone. Did you open the front door? No, yeah, I didn't. No, I didn't open the front door, no. No, I opened my bedroom window, which is on the first floor, and removed the screen, and he stuck his head into the window, and we carried on a conversation for 3 hours. So technically his whole body wasn't in the house and we didn't open the front door, but then later on he climbed through my bedroom window and we had a conversation and, you know, played video games, whatever. But no, I didn't open the front door. Did you hit your brother? Well, not exactly. I struck him with a baseball bat really hard, but no, I didn't hit him with my body parts. Oh, okay. So, deception might be in the same genre as lying because there's this intention of not presenting the truth. Point C under number two, causal slippery slope argument. A is wrong. If B is permitted, it's going to cause an increase in A. Therefore, B should be forbidden. This deals with empirical type data or questions. So, example, abortion is wrong. If you allow for the production, sale, in delivery of RU-486, the morning after pill, it's actually a series of pills, it's more than one pill, it will lead to abortion. Therefore, RU486 should be banned. We should not produce it. We should not allow for its sale. We should not allow for prescriptions to be written for that particular drug. This is this type of argument. Number three, a moral proposition is that which has the highest degree of incumbency or duty or obligation. This addresses questions like, do absolutes have exceptions? Are some morals more important, or are they all the same? Do we have a higher duty to preserve life than we do to tell truth? So, let's put it to the test. Let's pick on one of my students. Let's see how he fares with the deal, okay? Can I pick on you, bro?
You certainly can.
Thank you. So you and Patricia get married, and you've been married for like 4 or 5 years, and somebody breaks into the house in the front door. Patricia's upstairs in the bedroom, and this killer breaks in the house. He puts a gun in your face, and he says, "Is your wife here? I want to have sex with her." What are you going to tell him?
I'm going to tell him no.
Are you lying?
Yes.
Is that wrong to lie?
Yes.
But you're gonna sin.
I am.
Okay. So, that's right, and shoot him dead.
That's also
some cases it is, some cases. It's okay to kill if it's in defense of life. Somebody's attacking you, and the only way to stop that attack or stop his killing you is to kill him. That's morally acceptable. It's like the gal, this was on, YouTube had it too and some stuff, but I saw it on the news. This gal, I think in Texas, this guy was breaking into her house. She called 911. She's like, "Somebody's breaking into my back door." And she's like, "I have a gun. What should I do?" And the 911 operator said, "Well, I can't tell you what to do." She's like, "He's breaking into the door. I have to protect my son. I have to protect my son. What should I do? What should I do?" Then all of a sudden you hear boom, boom, boom. And the guy falls dead in her kitchen. He had a gun. He was going to rob her. And she killed him. There's no charges pressed against her. She was defending her life and the life of her child. So this third question raises the issue of duty or obligation. Do I have the duty to always tell the truth? You're hiding Jewish people. You're in Denmark, Corrie ten Boom. And the German Gestapo agents come to your door. Are you hiding Jews here? Now, if you're a Calvinist, you would say, "Yes, I am." Because God is sovereign and he's in control and moral absolutes never conflict. And so, yes, I am. Where are they? They're in between the walls. Let me show you where they are. God is in control. If he wants to blind them or drop them dead, he's got the prerogative and the sovereignty to do that. Situation number two. The Germans come to your door. Are you hiding Jews here? No, I'm not. And you close the door and they go away and you get down on your knees and you confess your sin. That's a Lutheran. It's true. Third situation. Are you hiding Jews here? No, I'm not. The Gestapo go away, you close the door, and you rejoice that you've been obedient to God to protect life. That's the Methodists. Different worldview. Different view on how we should respond to different obligations to preserve life and to tell the truth. What would you do? If truth is truth, it must exclude something, namely falsehood. So now we're going to turn to our major topic, relativism. Why believe the relativist if he has no truth to offer? Francis Beckwith, in his excellent book, Relativism, Feet Planted in Midair, says, when morality is reduced to personal tastes, people exchange the moral question, what is good, for the pleasure question, what feels good? They assert their desires and then attempt to rationalize their choices with moral language, end quote. Letter A, types of relativism, cultural or descriptive relativism. Two, normative ethical relativism, two types, individual and social. We're going to get to those. 3, meta-ethical or conceptual relativism. Even terms of right and wrong are relative. As J.P. Moreland rightly says, put metaphysically, there is no such property as rightness. Doesn't exist. Rules out the very possibility of two societies ever having a moral difference. Or 4, ethical skepticism, two types, epistemological or ontological. Epistemological, you can't know, and ontological, they don't exist. We're not going to deal with most of those. Letter B, cultural descriptive relativism involves a factual thesis, not a moral thesis, and one that sociologists make. This one is relatively uninteresting. It acknowledges that moral differences do exist between cultures. It's a statement really about morality, not a statement of morality or what morality should be. This is a very weak view, even as a descriptive thesis, because there's common ethics cross-culturally in different cultures. The Christian should have no problem with this particular viewpoint. And in number 6, you have a comparison. Descriptive. There's 3 statements I want to give you pairs. The descriptive thesis is it's about facts. This society does and believes this. That's fact. They do this. They do believe this. The prescriptive thesis deals with values. People are valuable. Elders ought to be respected. Innocent people should not be punished. The guilty should be punished. Those are values. Next category over. The descriptive thesis is this is the case. This is the case. We think it's okay to have abortions anytime during pregnancy. This is the way it is, okay? But the prescriptive says this is the way things ought to be. That's very different. Things ought to be that life is sacred, life is preserved, people are valued, elders are respected, the guilty are punished, the innocent are let free. Next category over. Descriptive thesis is about morality. The prescriptive one is of morality. Philosopher Norm Geisler says ethics deals with what ought to be, not what is, end quote. And then another quote from Beckwith. Students feel safer as doubters than as believers, and as perpetual seekers rather than eventual finders. You know, this is the culture, the non-Christian culture. We want to look for truth. Sometimes they do. But they never want to find it, because when they find it, they got to buy into it. They got to live their lives according to it. And they need to communicate it to the rest of their friends.
Sorry, you said descriptive thesis was about morality. And what is
of morality. Letter C, normative ethical relativism. This is what we're after tonight. Individual is called subjectivism, societal. Relativism is called conventionalism. Quote from Francis Schaeffer, 20 years before his time, in understanding some of these trends in culture. If there is no absolute moral standard, then one cannot say in a final sense that anything is right or wrong. This view is prescriptive and unacceptable to the Christian. What's right or wrong is relative to one's culture, and they should follow it. Or what's right is relative to the individual and personal decisions. So here's a quote from a little bit out of our worldview, A Witch. And this is one of the books that I read in my research long ago. Stuart Ferrer says, the witch's own conscience is and must be the final arbiter. And if it rebels against some suggestion from the high priest, that's an authority place, high priestess, another authority source, or anyone else, he must follow his conscience. So if I feel like it's okay, if I feel like it's right, that makes it right. Because this is individual type of normative ethics. Whatever the individual decides makes it right. That's a pretty dangerous ethic. Or the interview that I had with a pagan back in Wisconsin, they actually agreed that I could tape record my phone conversation. I interviewed him. I actually did the worldview surveys that you're going to be doing in, is it next week that they're due? We need to talk about that tonight, worldview surveys. And when I took the worldview survey with him, I asked him a question about absolutes, and this is how he responded. He said, I don't think there's anything ultimate right and wrong, But as you progress through life, there's right and wrong that you learn from. Morality is a subjective experience. And he answered very clearly about what relativism is. It's subjective. If I feel it's bad, then it's bad. If I feel it's good, then I guess it's good. Until some point in time that I feel it's bad, then it becomes bad. But it's not bad when I feel that it's good. It's totally subjective. I was at Illinois State doing my lecture on witchcraft and the occult there. And one of the gals, student, involved in witchcraft, she asked me a question. I don't remember what it was. But after I answered her question, I said, may I ask you a question? She said, oh, yes, of course. I said, how do you know whether or not something's harmful? Because witches have this rule. They have one value statement about right and wrong. Here's the value statement. If it doesn't harm anyone, you're free to do it. That's not a bad ethic, but it's an incomplete ethic. And I asked her, I said, how do you know whether or not it's harmful to someone? And she, you know, she was actually seriously thinking. She gave it some serious thought. I could see it going on in her face. And she was thinking, and she said, I don't know. I said, that's the problem with your worldview. Because it has no foundation. It has no foundation by which to make decisions on whether or not something is good or bad, right or wrong, harmful or not harmful. It's totally subjective. It's the flaw in your system. Quote from Josh McDowell's book, Right from Wrong. When people reject truth as an objective standard, their view of life becomes distorted. When their view of life becomes distorted, they easily accept the counterfeits. When they accept the counterfeits, they begin to make wrong choices. When they make wrong choices, they suffer the consequences. The choice is quite literally truth or consequences. Your textbook that we're using, True for You, says, though relativists claim to own the label of tolerance, as we critique objective and moral relativism, we will see how incoherent, self-contradictory philosophy that this is far more dogmatic and narrow-minded than Christianity is. Relativism wants to say that they're tolerant, but they're not. Relativism is not a very tolerant worldview or position. Letter D, 7 fatal flaws with relativism. Number 1, relativists cannot accuse others of wrongdoing. Relativists cannot accuse others of wrongdoing. If relativism is true, you can't critique anybody else. You can't criticize anybody else, at least with subjectivism. Now, if you're a part of conventionalism, a society ethics, you could criticize somebody within your society, but you cannot criticize anybody outside your society. So, the vast majority of the homosexual lobby, I don't mean political lobby, but the homosexual movement in America, Most of those individuals are driven by a worldview that's founded on relativism. Whatever feels good to me is right. What right do you have to say that I can't love another person, irregardless of their gender? So this is a relativist worldview. But then they go and they criticize another totally different community in society, Christians. Christians, you don't have a right to say that my position or my lifestyle is wrong. Well, if you're a relativist, you can't accuse anybody of wrongdoing. You can't criticize anybody outside you or your particular society that you're a part of. And in reality, there cannot be any accountability. You can't call somebody on the carpet. So I know this is a little bit removed from, you know, your age bracket, but you know, back in the mid-80s, when South Africa was involved in apartheid and racially segregating culture, if you're black, you have no vote. If you're black, you can't hold any office of significance in the country. If you're black, we can throw you in jail whenever we want because the whites are in control. And students across America protested that. On my own campuses that I was at, students protested. They're atheists, these students. They're relativists. But they're protesting apartheid, which they should. But they have no basis for doing so as relativists. What right do you as American college students have to criticize another country on the other side of the planet? What right do you say that your values are better than theirs? That your values are right and theirs are wrong? What right do you have? Well, this is what the students of America did across the campuses. Secular campuses. I'm like, this is bizarre behavior for relativists. But they're reflecting the image of God in themselves. Because the image of God in them says that there is right and wrong. There is a God who exists. There are some things that are bad. And they're living this out. Two, relativists cannot complain about the problem of evil. Relativists cannot complain about the problem of evil. Dr. Guybet was debating an atheist down in the southeastern part of the United States. And during the debate, the atheist said, Christians have a problem. It's called the problem of evil. And he began to discount the existence of God and the relevance of Christianity because of the problem of evil. You're playing into Dr. Guybet's hands with this comment. So cross-examine time, Dr. Guybet rightly said, as an atheist, my friend, you are not entitled to use the word evil. Because as an atheist, evil does not exist. But it seems like in our discussion this evening, that you actually think that evil exists and you actually think that it's objectively bad. But how can you make those kinds of claims in light of your atheistic worldview? And the atheist got the point. The light went on. He's like, you're right, I'm not entitled to use this idea of evil. But Dr. Guybet says, but you think it's actually real. You actually think there's things that are objectively evil in the world. But with that, you've actually admitted the existence of God. Relativists cannot complain about the problem of evil. Relativists cannot rightly complain about the problem of evil. Gender discrimination, racism, rape, murder, injustice, oppression of the poor. I'm sorry, you can't complain about any of it if you're a relativist. Shut up and go home. You don't have a right to complain about it. There is no right and wrong. There's things that you don't like, but simply because you don't like it doesn't mean it's not good or acceptable. Beckwith says, there is no evil to discuss, only differing opinions about what is pleasant, desired, or not desired. Number three, relativists can't place blame or accept praise. Relativists cannot place blame or accept praise. Why? There's nothing objectively right or wrong. If there's nothing objectively right, nobody can do anything that's really, truly good in an objective sense. If there is no wrong, nobody can do anything that's really bad or blameworthy in an objective sense. So the relativist cannot place blame or accept praise. Four, relativists cannot make charges of unfairness or injustice, like racial apartheid in South Africa. They can't make charges. That's unfair. That's unjust. It shouldn't be that way. This just drives me nuts at times with some of these discussions in our culture. Relativists continually borrow from our worldview at the appropriate times to try to gain something. I'm saying, no, you're not going to borrow from me. I'm sorry. Your worldview doesn't support it. Either change your worldview or give up the discussion. There are no relativists expecting to be treated relatively. So I was doing the worldview survey in a dorm room at the University of Redlands, California. I was going through the survey, asked Kurt if he believed there's any absolute truth, any right or wrong. He said, no, it's all relative. And I tried to engage him for a couple of minutes on that. There was no movement in his life to actually move towards that there actually is right and wrong. And, you know, I get kind of crazy sometimes, and, you know, I tend to be extreme at times and in my examples, or sometimes, you know, I'm not illegal, but, you know, I'll push the boundaries a little bit sometimes. And so I think I might have told you the story, but I walked over to his desk and I began to unplug his computer, power cord and his attachment to the keyboard, and I picked up his computer and I started making for the door. And he said, "You can't do that." I said, "Oh, it's not too heavy, actually. I've been working out lately, and it's pretty light. I think I can handle it. It's okay." He said, no, you can't do that." I said, "What do you mean I can't do it?" I said, "You know, if relativism is true, might makes right. And my friend and I are two against one, you. So I think I have the power to actually do this, even if you don't like it." No, you can't do that." "Oh, what do you mean I can't do it?" He said, "I'll call the police." I said, "You know, it's interesting. You just turned into an absolutist. You actually think it's wrong that I take your computer. Now, how can you think that it's wrong? Why would you call the police if you don't think it's wrong? You actually think that my action is morally wrong. But you're a relativist, and you're not entitled to that conclusion that you're making right now, are you?" Silence. And because he's silent, I know that he knows that I'm right. Because he's not arguing with me. He can't say anything in rebuttal. It's obvious. It's obvious. But he doesn't want to admit the obvious. Sometimes silence gives the strongest answer, sometimes. 5, relativists cannot improve their morality. They can't improve on their morality. There is no morality to improve on. Things can change. Things could be different, but it's not an improvement, it's just a change. So, you know, yesterday you ran over old ladies, but today you helped them across the street. Yes, that's a change, but there's no moral difference or ethical difference between those two situations if you're a relativist. One of my friends said, "You know how to tell if so-and-so's lying?" I said, "No." I said, how do you tell?" He said, "Their lips are moving." Six, relativists cannot hold meaningful moral discussions. There is no morality to discuss, and yet they want to have moral discussions. You know, I don't know what stories I've shared with you. I was at Cal Poly Pomona. I've been there quite a lot. In fact, this last 5 weeks I've been there 4 times, but this story is from about 5 years ago when I debated an atheist, D.J. Grothis. And as we're talking, he said 2 arguments he had. He said, "If you can't see it, it's not real." And he said, "There's not enough empirical evidence to support the conclusion or the notion of God." And when I had some cross-examine time, I said to him, a student actually, it was during the Q&A time, student asks a question about ethics. And I said, "So DJ," I said, "let's say that you have an 80,000 BMW. My car is very old, it's about ready to die, and I really need to replace it. Yours is practically brand new. So I go and get my 9mm Glock semi-automatic pistol, put some bullets in the clip, and I put 2 bullets in your head. It only cost me about 55, 57 cents for those 2 bullets. You're dead. You don't need your car anymore, so I get your car." I said, "It's very beneficial for me to put you to death so that I get your 80,000 car. No payments. I'm good to go." I said, "The consequences are very good for me." And he says, "Yeah, but the consequences aren't good for me." I said, "Well, that's, you know, I don't really care about the consequences with you. Because if relativism is true, it's just what benefits me." And I said, "So how are you going to solve our conflict?" And he's like, he goes, "Flatline." Beep. No response. Because as an atheist, he cannot adjudicate or decide between conflicting views. There's nothing to appeal to. You can't appeal to any objective standard outside the individual or culture. So he's absolutely silent on this. Relativists cannot promote the obligation of tolerance. Relativists cannot promote the obligation of tolerance because tolerance is a transcultural value. Tolerance is a transcultural value. So, quote from Josh McDowell, right from wrong. "If there are no moral absolutes, why be tolerant at all? Why not force my morality on others if it's in my self-interest and my personal ethics allow for it?" E, problems with relativism. 1, it's difficult to define what is a society. It's difficult to define what a society is. So, say that you're taking a course or two at the local junior college. And at the local junior college, you decide to join a fraternity. And one of the requirements for being a part of the fraternity at the local JC is you have to party hardy on Friday night. You have to slam dunk, you know, at least a six-pack of Budweiser. You know, you can do Bud Light if you want, but, you know, you have to basically get inebriated, get drunk, you know, laugh at the grass, call Ralph, you know, worship the porcelain throne, you know, things like that. Get drunk until you vomit. But at Biola, you're part of the society at Biola, and you've made a decision when you signed your contract that you're not going to drink alcohol while you're on contract, of which all Biola students adhere to, right? You're part of two societies. Now you have a conflict with those two societies, which is point two. A person may belong to more than one society or do an action in another society. So this used to happen with the drinking age. I'll, you know, keep on pounding away at the drinking age here. Before the United States had uniform drinking age of 21, students in Nebraska, where the law was 21, they would drive across the border to Iowa, and they would get drunk because the drinking age in Iowa was 18. So a lot of them would drive across the border, get drunk in Iowa. Now they made the mistake of getting in their cars and driving back to Nebraska. Now they got alcohol in their system and they're drunk. And when they cross the border, the law now is 21. Yeah, they drank the alcohol in a state where the legal drinking age is 18. But now you're back in your home state of Nebraska, and the drinking age is 21. This presents a problem, so they pick up tickets anyway. They should have stayed in Iowa until they were sober, and they would have been, quote, legal by the state definition. Three, problem of the moral reformer. Problem of a moral reformer. Could there really be a moral reformer in a legitimate way? J.P. Moreland, Scaling the Secular City, says, moral reformers, by definition, change a society's code, arguing that it is somehow morally inadequate. So, Martin Luther King Jr., he argues that it's high time that the American government and culture and society delivered on its promises that all men are created equal and are endowed with their Creator with certain inalienable rights, such as life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And he says it's high time our culture delivered on this issue. If relativism is true, Martin Luther King Jr. had no right to challenge the status quo of culture. But he challenged it. Thankfully, challenged it peacefully, thankfully, even though the response from the government and the reigning culture, white culture, was not very peaceful. It was extremely violent and belligerent. But I give him a lot of credit. He actually pursued it peacefully. He deserves tremendous accolades for that paradigm of trying to influence culture peacefully. The culture at hand did not respond to him very peacefully at all. He was thrown into jail many times, wrongly so. Our country owes an apology to those that were alive during that time where we did not deliver on the promise that all men are created equal. So if relativism were true, what Martin Luther King did and argued for is morally wrong. Say that in a crowded room. Go ahead, in our culture today. Oh, Martin Luther King was, you know, wrong in what he did. He was unethical and immoral, trying to argue for equal rights. Holy man alive, your life might be in jeopardy with saying that in the culture today. Four, some actions are wrong regardless of social convention. Some actions are wrong regardless of social convention. Torturing babies for fun. That's the most extreme examples, or extreme example, and the vast majority of people, I don't know anybody that would say, oh, no, that's okay. That just depends upon your personal desire for pleasure. Or raping women for pleasure. Now, some fools might agree to that, but 99.99% of the sane culture would say, of course that's wrong. Of course it's wrong. Hello. So this point four, a strategy is to cite clear examples of moral absolutes. Kindness is a virtue. It's wrong to torture babies for fun. It's wrong to imprison people who never committed the crime, that are innocent. And then we shift the burden of proof to the relativist. J.P. Moreland in Love God with All Your Mind says, a virtue is an ingrained disposition. That's true. He wrote the book, The Lost Art of Happiness, which talks about virtue and other things. Five, it's impossible for one society to blame another society. Under any aspect of relativism, whether it's an individual relativism or a conventionalism, a society relativism, society A is not allowed to not allowed to blame society B. So America has no right to blame South Africa for apartheid. This is interesting. This came, you know, this whole issue of relativism came into crisis during the Nuremberg trials after World War II, when we put on a lot of German Gestapo and German Nazis with killing Jews. And as they began to try them, the Germans' defense was, I didn't break any laws. I only obeyed orders. I obeyed orders and I broke no laws. So the prosecution kind of went into freeze frame. They're like, how do we prosecute? How do we prosecute? Do we impose our American values on Germany as a country? Do we just say, well, you didn't obey all of America's laws? Well, dude, we're an independent country. We're a sovereign nation, Germany. What right do you as another nation on the other side of the planet, what right do you have to dictate to us the rules? To demand that we obey your laws. And so the prosecution didn't know where to go. So he took a break in the proceedings. He had to think, and he came back, and he tried them based upon what? Crimes against humanity. He was arguing for a universal. Rightly so. Relativism is true. I don't think we had a right to put on trial the Nazis. They broke no laws, they only obeyed orders. Relativism is not a very good system. If there are no absolutes beyond man's ideas, then there is no final appeal to judge between individuals and groups whose moral judgments conflict. We are merely left with conflicting opinions. Francis Schaeffer. Number six, relativism really is an absolutist position. It's really an absolute position. All truth is relative. Really? All truth is relative? My position that relativism is true should be accepted by all people because it's true for everyone. Oh, wow. Wow. That's an absolutist position. So relativism is really not relative. Relativists really are arguing that it's universally true for all. But if relativism is true, then it's false. Self-defeating. Seven, it's a self-defeating claim. My view that nothing is universally true is true universally. Oh, how ironic. Eight, it's a self-accepting fallacy. My view applies to everyone but myself. Sounds like the United States Senate. Do you know that none of their civil laws that they've enacted, none of their medical laws with Obamacare, none of them apply to them? Did you know that? They're not going to be a part of the national health care system. The representatives and senators are exempt from it. Hiring practices, you can't discriminate based upon ethnicity. You have to have a certain quota of different people if you have a certain size company. They've exempted themselves from those laws. Saw somebody circulating an amendment to the Constitution. All laws that are passed by Congress should equally apply to them as it does to the American people. Oh, boy, would I vote for that one. Holy man alive. Woo! They want to accept themselves. Self-accepting fallacy of relativism. Nine, relativism violates our deepest moral intuitions. We know that some things are wrong without being able to give proof for it. We know things, not necessarily moral things, but that too. My hand is injured, I say to you. And you ask, well, how do you know it's injured? So, well, because it hurts. How do you know it hurts, John? Because I feel it. But how do you know that you feel it? Well, because I'm self-aware and I'm aware of the pain that I'm experiencing. 10, relativism would mean that there are no immoral laws, only laws. This kind of tangents off to a myth that gets bought in our culture. You can't legislate morality. Well, yes and no. Every time you pass a law, it's legislating a moral principle. You shouldn't kill people. You shouldn't steal cars. You shouldn't cheat on your income taxes. You shouldn't burn down your neighbor's house. That's legislating what the government thinks is morally right or morally wrong behavior. Now, you're right, you can't legislate morality in the sense of behavior. I cannot make you behave a certain way. You still have the freedom to break the law, to make morally wrong choices. Anybody ever here in their life ever made a morally wrong choice? Yeah, all of us. Even though that the Bible says or the state says or the law says thou shalt not do whatever, we still have the freedom to break it. So you cannot force people to do certain behaviors unless you put the gun to their head. Say, if you do that, I'm going to kill you. Okay, I probably won't do that in the next 5 minutes while you got the gun to my head. When you take the gun away and you walk away, then I might do it. 11, there'd be no possibility of virtue since virtue cannot exist. Shortly after the 9/11 fiasco, where peace-loving Muslims hijacked airplanes in an attempt to kill as many Americans as possible. Peace-loving Muslims. Some want to say they're extremists. Maybe. Maybe. Maybe not. Because Islam has a violent ethic embedded in its worldview. If you don't agree, like when I was at the University of Nebraska at Kearney, and I asked Muhammad, I said, what do you do with, I said, am I an infidel? He said, I don't know. I said, I believe that Jesus Christ is Allah. Am I an infidel? He said, yes, you are. I said, what do you do with infidels in your country, Saudi Arabia? He said, he looked at me, he says, we put them to death. I said, that's why I'm glad I'm in America. I have the choice to believe what I want, and I don't get killed for it. So right after the 9/11 fiasco, shortly after it, there was a billboard, poster on one of the billboards on the I-10, the north side of I-10, right before you get to Ontario as you're traveling west from San Bernardino. I live in San Bernardino. So the first time I saw this thing, oh golly, oh man, I almost lost control of the car. It had the rubble of the World Trade Center in the picture, and it had a silhouette of a fireman with his hat on and dust all over his face. And then it had a caption. It said, they ran in while others ran out. And then in big letters it said, courage. When I saw that the first time, the second time, the third time, I just started to cry. Just started to bawl my eyes out because it hit my heart and it hit values that I hold very dear. But if relativism is true, those firefighters were absolute idiots. Because to preserve other people's lives is not virtue if his relativism is true. But every American that has any appreciation for ethics or virtue, when they see that sign, their heart would break and there would be emotion that comes out of their heart. Courage. They ran in while others ran out. Anybody see the new film? You probably haven't. Valor. See that film? It's a little edgy, but it talks about American soldiers defending America, giving their life to defend America. Is that virtuous? Was the firefighters going in to save people's lives? Was that virtuous? Or is that the ultimate in stupidity? If relativism is true, there is no virtue in their actions. But we know deep within our soul, we know in a self-evident way, we know because of the scriptures, we know because of the existence of God, we know because of the existence of moral absolutes, we know that their conduct is virtuous, not foolishness. But relativism would try to tell us otherwise. Letter D, false claims for relativism and rebutting them. Some of this is from your book reading, True for You. So many people disagree. That must mean that relativism is true. We got difference of opinion. People are conflicting. Well, this is okay. No, it's not okay. Well, yeah, this is okay. This is. And there's conflict within culture, conflict between societies on what is right or wrong. And because there's so much disagreement, that means that everything is relative. No, it doesn't mean that at all. Why is your answer to the disagreement the only possible explanation? We need to consider other things like different philosophical starting points or assumptions. Yes, a person's birthplace might explain the source of their belief, but it doesn't determine the reality or the truthfulness of their belief. Two, another possible response to the relativist, people lack knowledge. Biases can prevail. Someone could be wrong. They could be mistaken. They could be deceived. We have different starting assumptions. I did a survey for one of my classes a class that I took many years ago. And it was a communication class. And we had to take a survey. We had to go out and ask people to rank five different statements or words. Freedom, salvation, sanctity of life, or maybe it was just, I don't know if it was sanctity of life, but it was something along those lines. Five different statements. But before we asked them to rank them in top priority, number one priority, two priority, three priority, four priority, five priority, we had to ask them a polarizing question. We weren't going to pursue the discussion. We just had to ask them this question up front. Would you consider yourself pro-life or pro-choice? And didn't matter what they said. We weren't after that so much. And then after we asked them that question, we'd give them these five things, frequently on, say, a 3x5 card. Say, would you rank these for me? What's most important to you? What's least important? Rank them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Those that said that they were pro-life ranked salvation number one. And usually ranked freedom number five. Those that said they were pro-choice ranked freedom number one and ranked salvation number five. Both groups of people had the exact same values, but in different order. So a researcher at USC, Milton Rokish, who did lots of study on this area, proposed a principle he called it the ipsative principle. And he said people within the same culture usually share the same values. But frequently what they do is they arrange those values in a different order of priority. So I asked people in the same city, the same culture, and I got those rankings. If they said they were pro-choice, they ranked freedom number one, salvation number five. If they said they were pro-life, they ranked salvation number one, they ranked freedom number five. Same values. Different order. Number three, some self-refuting statements by relativists. My view that everything is relative should be accepted by everyone. There is no objective truth since everything is relative. The implications of relativism, number one, persuasion tends to be prohibited. Because, hey, you got your truth, I got my truth, our truth is the same, even though our truth conflicts. Everything's relative. You can make your own decisions. I can make my own decisions. So don't try to persuade me concerning anything, but they try to persuade you that relativism is true. But it's not acceptable for you and I as Christians to try to persuade them that there's absolute truth. So it's a one-sided issue. Or, I told you the story before, bears repeating, it's relevant for this statement. Persuasion is prohibited. So when I was at State University of New York at Buffalo, after my lecture, a girl came up to me and she said, John, I don't think it's right for you to force your views on others. And I said in response, what are you trying to do to me right now? And her boyfriend or friend next to her said, he's right. It's impossible to force someone to believe anything. In fact, it's impossible to force yourself to believe anything. Belief acquisition is much more complicated than just making a decision of your will. Persuasion is prohibited. It's ethically responsible to persuade if that persuasion is in the benefit of the other individual. Your best friend breaks up. with their significant other and then wants to commit suicide? Would you try to convince your best friend not to commit suicide? Would you try to persuade them? Would you try to talk them out of it? Yeah, of course you would. If you're their friend, absolutely, you're gonna do everything in your power. My Chinese friends, one of the guys, I had lunch with him yesterday. We read part of a chapter out of Case for Christ. We talked about him becoming a Christian. And he said, well, what do I have to believe again? I said, you have to believe that Jesus is God. You have to believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins. You have to believe that Jesus rose from the grave. And he said, so if I believe those things, then I'm a Christian. I said, no, those things are necessary. But you still have to make a decision to enter into a personal relationship with Jesus. You actually have to trust him to pay the penalty for your sins. And you have to enter into this relationship, this friendship with him. In the past, recent past, I said to him, Quan, I said, if I had cancer and you were a cancer doctor, specialist, how much energy would you use to try to convince me to take the treatment? He said, I would use every ounce of my strength, John, to try to convince you to take the cure. I said, my friend, you have cancer. It's called sin. And you're under the penalty of death because of your sin. You're separated from God. And I said, I know what the solution is. It's a relationship with Jesus Christ. I said, how much energy should I use to try to convince you? The light went on for him. He's like, I guess every ounce of your strength. I said, and that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to try every possible avenue to persuade you. Number two, absolute truth claims are seen as arrogant and should be abhorred. Relativism says this. If relativism is true, relativism says absolute truth claims are seen as arrogant. How can you believe that something is right objectively? How can you say that everybody that disagrees with you is wrong? You know, we get this. We get this, you know, different ways. You know, with the Jesus question, Jesus being the way, the truth, and life. People say, man, isn't that a little bit narrow? Aren't you being kind of arrogant? You're saying that Jesus is the only way? That's because they don't believe in objective truth. Jesus is the only one in human history that claimed to be God. You don't have a whole lot of people vying for the position. Gandhi never claimed to be God. Moses never claimed to be God. Muhammad never claimed to be God. If you said to Muhammad, I think you're God, he would have hacked your head off. That's blasphemy. He would have killed you right on the spot for saying such a thing. So none of these religious leaders ever claimed to be God. So it's not like you have to evaluate 25 people in human history. Oh yeah, you know, he said he's God, he said he's God. Yeah, we got 25. How are you ever going to decide? You only got one in human history that's ever claimed to be God, Jesus. Maybe his claim is actually true. Three, another implication of relativism. Power and rhetoric rules the discussion, not an appeal to truth. Bill Clinton is the poster boy for this. Rhetoric and manipulation of the English language and power. It's not an appeal to truth. And then in relativism, tolerance is the supreme value. So, next page, you have a sheet on eight systems, moral systems. We'll cover this, and then we'll talk about the worldview survey. Number one, relativism, which we've been talking about most of this class time. Relativism says, what might be wrong for you might be right for me. Comment, no relativists want to be treated in a relative manner. And another question with relativism, how do you resolve conflict? Like my atheist friend at Pomona, when I said, you know, I mean, two bullets is only going to cost me, you know, a little over 50 cents. Why shouldn't I do that? It has great consequences for me, because his ethical system was consequentialism, it's called. Atheists, I don't know why in the world, but atheists are frantically writing books about ethics. This is an oxymoron. You don't believe in ethics. Why are you trying to write books on ethics and virtue? This doesn't make sense to my mind. So they come up with a system of ethics called consequentialism. If it has positive consequences, it's good. If it has negative consequences, it's bad. So I said, hey, killing you, getting your BMW has got great consequences for me. Only cost me 50 cents. I should do it then, right? Because it's got great consequences. He said, well yeah, but it doesn't have good consequences for me. Okay, bad consequences for you, good consequences for me. How do we solve the conflict? I don't know. That's what he says in response. Why? Because he has no objective standard. Number two, utilitarianism. Two types of utilitarianism. Utilitarianism says the ends justify the means. Two types, rule, certain principle, and act, an individual action. Dr. Kevorkian, the physician-assisted suicide guy from Detroit, Michigan, applied this principle in putting to death his patients, many of them that were not terminally ill, but depressed, and so he helped kill them. In some cases, he actually killed them himself by injecting lethal doses of painkiller or other things into their bloodstream. Utilitarian ethics was used to justify the dropping of the atomic bomb on Japan twice, where we killed 250,000 people in one day. And the next time we dropped the other bomb, we killed another 250,000. Why? Because supposedly we're going to save a lot of American lives, probably. And less Japanese people will be ultimately killed by dropping the bomb instead of attacking the mainland and having all this killing. So because we're going to actually save American lives and actually not kill as many Japanese people, it's okay for us to obliterate 500,000 innocent civilians. It's utilitarian in its ethical system. I think it was wrong to drop the atomic bomb on civilians. That's not a part of a just war. Yes, we might have lost a lot more Americans. I grant you that. But the ends don't necessarily justify the means. And how does one know what the ends will be? How do you know what the ends will be? Utilitarianism says, seek the greatest good for the greatest number. It's not all bad, but that principle can run into problems. And how do you know what's going to actually do that? And what will that entail? Number three, emotivism. If it feels good, do it. A lot of pedophiles could use that for a rationalization with their wrong behavior. Question, feel good for how long? 5 minutes? Or 50 years. I made some choices in high school that felt really good for 5 minutes. But now I got to live with the remorse for my whole life. Feel good for how long? Anarchy, anything goes. You had sure better hope that you shoot before I do. And that you load your gun before I load mine, if that's the name of the game. I don't think you or I would want to live in such a society or world. Something is going to come into that vacuum of anarchy to fill the void that's been created by lawlessness and disorder. Six, totalitarianism, might makes right. Jesus says, he who lives by the sword is going to die by the sword. Totalitarianism, yeah, you just justified Hitler and Stalin and Mao and Pol Pot. Greatest murderers in human history, Mao taking the prize with killing 35 million Chinese people. Great man? No, a butcher and a killer. Deontology, number seven. Just do the right thing. Nike. Just do the right thing. It's true, but it's hard to do. Virtue ethics. Dr. Horner, he did his dissertation in this area of virtue ethics. Most of the scriptures are this principle-based ethics, doing that which is right, irregardless of the fallout. And in eight, virtue, character is king and it counts. That's right on the mark, and we need more of it. Which systems does the scripture support? Which does it reject? It definitely supports number seven and number eight, principle-based ethics, and it supports virtue theory. So not only is the question, like I had you read that one article, the three M's, what's the means, what's the motive, what's the manifestation? What's the motive that you're doing something? What's the means that you're using to accomplish that thing? And what's the manifestation? And the manifestation is actually twofold. What is the actual results that take place? So if I'm a doctor and somebody's in pain, I say, I'll just end their life. So I inject them with some lethal dose of morphine, and I take their life. The end result is that patient dies. And that's not a good result, especially if they have the ability to live for another 5 months or 5 years or 50 years. That would be a very morally wrong choice. But there's another thing that our culture doesn't consider as much, and that is, what's it going to do to me personally? How's it going to affect my character? I have a friend that teaches. He's on staff with Campus Crusade, teaches at Yale University, one class. Gets the cream of the crop freshmen, and he teaches them a class dealing with philosophy and ethics. He's done a fair amount of writing. I just saw him at the ETS conference in November, Greg Gansel. And he's teaching this section on ethics with his class, the top freshmen at Yale. I'm like, holy man, that's great. And this one girl in class discussion, they're talking about, why is something wrong? And she says in the class discussion, she says, because it does violence to your soul. Right answer. It's not just wrong because the culture says it's wrong. It's not wrong simply because the state declares a law. But one of the reasons is wrong because it does violence to your soul. It has a negative manifestation in your life. So a woman comes to an ethics professor here at Biola University, the professor, Paul Cox, friend of mine at that time. This woman comes to him, she's a Christian, she comes to him and says, my sister who's a Christian is married to an atheist and they're having difficulty having children. She cannot gestate the baby. They can get pregnant, but because of things going on medically with her, she cannot carry the baby for any length of time. And so she's losing every one of her pregnancies. And this single woman comes to the ethics professor here and says, my sister has asked me to be a surrogate mother. They're going to take an egg from my sister, from her husband's sperm, they're going to fertilize that egg, and they want to implant it in my womb and for me to carry the child for her. And then her sister, the married girl, says, you know, my husband's not a believer, and this act of sacrifice and love on your part might actually bring him to faith in Jesus Christ. Will you do this for us? So this woman is struggling with this decision. So she goes to the ethics professor. And he says, you need to ask a number of questions, but one of the questions you need to ask in this deliberation is, what will it do to your soul? How will it affect your character? Will you become a better person, or will this action actually eat away at your character? And as she processed these things, she decided not to be a surrogate mother, which I think is actually a good decision. I think it's the appropriate decision. But we have conflict in our culture. Ladies, you want to get about $25,000 to $30,000 for your next year's tuition? Just be a surrogate mother. There's people waiting to pay you $25,000 to $30,000 to carry their baby for them. It's big business. It's big business. There's a news article I cut out March 4 years ago. It's about actually Japan, not exactly a Christian country. The article, the title says, panel calls for ban on surrogate births. Surrogate births should be banned, and those involved in such medical arrangements on a commercial basis punished by a new law, an academic panel said Friday. The report compiled by the panel under the Science Council of Japan, at the request of the government, recommends that surrogate births be outlawed in light of the physical and mental burdens that are borne by women serving as surrogate mothers and the psychological implications for the children born in this manner. Interesting. This is not driven by a Christian worldview. It is not known if the government will submit to the legislature a bill based on the recommendations because a health, labor, and welfare ministry report that proposed banning surrogate births was shelved in the past. Here's a non-Christian nation that is coming up with the conclusion that surrogate motherhood and birth is not healthy for anybody involved. I think they're right. Relativism does not give us the basis to make any decisions about anything. Relativism is wrong. Relativism is faulty. There's many flaws with it that we've talked about tonight. If you'll turn in your notes, I think this might be towards the front of your course pack, and I'm not sure, but turn to the section where you've got worldview surveys. Let me use one if I could. And your assignment for next week, if you haven't done it yet, is to take this worldview survey. 8 questions. The goal is to try to have some dialogue with people. The survey will help them unpackage their worldview. Some people will be relativists. Some people will actually be absolutists. Okay, week 8, it is. So 2 weeks from tonight. That's the old syllabus. Sorry. Next week. We're back on for next week. So 8 questions. The first one, do you think there's any universal truth? Things that are true regardless of a person's opinion. Why or why not? Most people are going to have a trouble with this statement, universal truth. They won't know what you mean. If you want to substitute, is there any such thing as objective truth? They're still not going to probably understand the question half the time. So you don't want to give them the answer to the question in order for them to understand the question, but good luck on that one. I've tried to define it by things that are true regardless of a person's opinion. You could give them an example, but it might taint the water supply. But you can try if you want, if you have to. Is it wrong for everybody to torture babies for fun? Is that wrong for everybody? Or is that just wrong for people that, you know, really like babies, but, you know, it's not wrong for people that don't like babies? Or is it wrong for everybody? You give them an example. And then you ask why or why not. They might say, no, there is no universal truth. Why? Well, we're just all products of Darwinian evolution. We're just, you know, mutations of amoebas. All we are is physical substances, and so there's no reason to suggest that there's any objective truth. There's no God that exists, maybe somebody says. Okay, fine. You don't disagree with them. You're asking them questions. You're helping them unpackage their worldview. You're trying to get some interaction with them. Do you think that racism is wrong? In other words, hating people simply based upon their ethnicity. Well, you're going to get a strong reaction on this question. People are going to be almost upset that you've asked the question. Kind of like you're suggesting there might be different answers on the question. Do you think racism is wrong? Of course racism is wrong, they'll say to you. Why? Well, you know, it's wrong to hate people based upon their skin color. They haven't told you why. They've just reiterated the definition of racism. Well, why is it wrong to hate people based upon skin color? Well, it just is. Well, why is it just is? Well, they're all human beings. So, what difference does that make? Nobody's going to give you an answer. Unless you might bump into a Christian and a couple of them will actually have a right answer. Why is it wrong to hate people based upon skin color? We're created in the image of God. We're inherently valuable, not because of our ethnicity or our geographical location, or because of our economic status, or how smart we are, or what gender we are, or how tall we are, or how handsome we are, or how beautiful we are. It's because we're created in the image of God. But nobody in the culture will know this. No, nobody knows it. But they'll say, well, of course racism is wrong. They're right on their conclusion. Racism is wrong, they're right on it. But they don't have a clue why. Then the next question. Do you think it's wrong to judge another person's beliefs or actions? Well, of course it's wrong. You shouldn't be judging other people. Why? Well, you know, everybody's entitled to their own opinions. Maybe they're a relativist and this conclusion that they've just made on 3 is consistent with their worldview of relativism. So then you push a little harder. At this point, you can push a little bit. Would it be wrong for us to judge the racist and say that the racist is wrong? Oh, boy. Stress is going to go off the charts right now. Some people will say to you, are you trying to trick me? Me try to trick you? Of course I am. I'm trying to show you that your worldview is inconsistent. And if your worldview is inconsistent, it cannot be true. Four, do you think morality in America is getting better or worse? Most people say it's worse. Why? Well, you know, the media and, you know, education, you know. If you get somebody that's 45 and older, they're going to say, absolutely, you know, those young kids just don't know how to control themselves anymore. They're just out of control. You know, they need a good spanking, or they need to get straightened out, you know. Or, you know, so you're going to get this. And you're going to get this from a wide gamut of people. Now, some people are going to say it's not getting better or worse. Why? Because they're a relativist, and some relativists are actually going to be consistent. Not very many of them. But they're going to try to be consistent. What do you think the purpose of life is? I'm bored with that question, not because it's not a significant question, but because I don't get any significant answers. They'll say, to be happy. Wonderful. What's it going to take for you to be happy? Have a family. That's nice. Thank you. Six, what do you think happens when a person dies? You're going to get the three options. Heaven and hell, which is, you know, resurrection, or reincarnation, or refuse. You're going to be fertilizer. You're going to be dust. So those are the three possible options that you're going to get. And then you ask people, why do you believe that? They're going to give you, what's your view of God? What is your view of God? If you want to stop there, you can stop, you know, you don't have to ask the second part of the question, but if you want to amp it up a little bit, you can ask the second part of the question, because it's going to get some people amped up when you use the personal masculine pronoun. What is he like? He, that's going to get you into trouble with some people. If you want to avoid the trouble, don't ask the second question. Just say, what is your view of God? Well, he doesn't exist. An atheist. Or, he's very gracious. He's loving, you know. He doesn't really care what you do in life. On the survey, when you take the interview? Yeah, when you do the interview with people, write in their answers. Yep, use the three that are provided. You'll need to make more on your own because you have to interview five different interactions. So the assignment is not five people. You don't get a group of five. You pass out the survey, have them fill it out, and you're done. You just violated the assignment. You'll get 0 points. The goal is to sit down with a person. If you want to do two at the same time, that's okay, but that only counts as one interaction. So I want you to have to take five initiatives. Sit down with people. Tell them what you're doing. I've got a class. Tell them whatever you want. You can tell them it's, you know, they don't know what the word apologetics is. So you can tell them I've got a class. It's kind of like philosophy class. And I've got to ask people about their worldview. And they're like, worldview, whatever that is. Okay, well, I'll help you. You know, and so you do the survey. Say, do you think there's any universal truth? Anything that's objectively true across the board with everybody you like? You know, you shouldn't kill innocent people. And I said, well, okay. You write it in. So you start writing down their responses, but you want dialogue with them. This isn't the goal. No, your goal is to build some relationship, to have some dialogue. I don't want you to take it with believers. So if you find out that they're a believer, you can still take it with them. It will count. But I do not want you to target believers. I want you to target people that are not believers. Well, it's acceptable to do it with one or two of them, not the whole five, and that could be very productive also for them and for you to do that. So that's okay. And I would prefer that you do this face-to-face versus on a chat room or internet. You can do it on the phone, but I prefer that you'd have some face-to-face interactions with people so you can also develop the interpersonal dynamic and not just fill in answers on the survey. So some people, when you get to question three and they fill in question three, some people are actually going to have something called cognitive dissonance. They're going to realize that there's a stress point in their worldview when they say there is no truth, racism is wrong for everybody, and you shouldn't judge people. They're going to begin to feel some cognitive dissonance. And some people, not a lot of them, but some people are actually going to stop you and say, can we go back to question one? I want to change my answer to question one. I actually think there is absolute truth. So could we change that? Oh yeah, sure, we can change it. Why do you want to change it? You played dumb. Why do you want to change it? Well, I think racism is wrong for all people, and therefore it actually might be right for me to judge somebody who is a racist and to say that that's a wrong behavior or a wrong point of view. Anybody ever remember the old detective movie series, Columbo? Anybody ever remember that, Columbo? Great situation. He just, I'm having a hard time figuring something out. I wonder if you could help me. And they'd ask these well-placed questions. And he'd keep on asking questions until this person is highly uncomfortable. And he's beginning to show them the flaws in their alibi or the flaws in what they're saying. It's not consistent. And he begins to pick apart their alibi or their worldview by keep on asking them questions. And he asks them in such a non-assuming manner. He doesn't raise his voice. He doesn't tell them they're the killer or they're lying. He just subtly asks them this question. That's what the worldview survey will do to some extent. So feel free to dialogue with people. Feel free to try to persuade them. Don't jump in too quickly, though. Wait until after question three, or wait until towards the end of the survey to actually jump in. And some of them will ask you, well, what do you think about this? How would you answer this question? And then question eight, if it were possible to have an intimate relationship with God, how would you rate your desire to have that type of relationship? 1 to 10, with 10 being high. And you might say, well, 10. Well, you know what? I give you my permission to tell them about Jesus. Talk to them. If they're open to hearing, tell them about Jesus. Tell them about the Lord. It's one of the reasons we have opportunities to interact with people. You get an opportunity to share with people about the truth.
Biola University offers a variety of biblically centered degree programs, ranging from business to ministry to the arts and sciences. Visit biola.edu to find out how Biola could make a difference in your life.